Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy.
Thank you. and welcome folks to our worship service at Trading Ford Baptist Church today. If you are visiting with us, you are an honored guest here in the Lord's house today, and we are so grateful. But a tomb that holds his remains. We serve our Lord Jesus Christ, and he is risen. He is alive. And we are so, so very thankful. We are so grateful. This morning, after hearing that song by the ensemble, and by the way, wasn't that a blessing? Thank you, ensemble. Great job helping us celebrate this Easter and to kick off this service. But the next thing on the agenda is to see some folks take the step of following Christ in believers' baptism. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that wonderful? So those who are going to be taking that step, if you would go ahead and make your way to the, well, you know, I started to say, not red carpet, but blue plastic. Yes, blue plastic. Make your way there, and we will help you take that step of following Christ in baptism. Amen. So excited for each one of these folks. Amen. Okay, Belinda, looks like you're first. Belinda, upon your profession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. 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 Next, we have Sharon. I have a little backstory to say. The other Sunday, when a couple of the ladies came forward to say, "I want to take the step of following the Lord in baptism, and I want to unite with this church in membership," I announced them as my sisters. Well, they are my sisters in Christ, not my biological sisters, but you know what? The connection we have in Jesus is more important even than that biological connection. Amen. And we're so thankful. And Sharon, upon your profession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. 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 Good job. And while the next person is getting ready, it would be a good idea for me to just say thank you to our team that takes care of putting this baptistry in place and getting it ready. Thank you, guys. We appreciate you so much. Now, the next person taking this step is a biological sister to the lady that we just baptized. And Karen, upon your profession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. So proud of y'all. So proud of y'all. Yeah, they are twin sisters. That will actually connect with something in the message today, so you're going to have to be listening to see what connection that is.
Jenna, upon your profession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Proud of y'all. And Jenna's husband, Scott, will be next. Scott, they let the guys go last. Good morning. They let the guys go last so the ladies can have longer to get ready and to change. Yeah. We don't mind letting them do that. Scott, upon your profession of faith in the Lord Jesus as your personal Savior, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Folks, what a blessing in the life of our church to be able to see these folks take that step. Now, I have baptism certificates for each of them. However, we're going to give them at the end of the service, because right now they would get a little wet. They would, the ink may get a little blurry from the water, but we'll give those away at the end. Right now, as we transition, we have a video that we want you to watch. Pay close attention.
I grew up in a ministry home. We were a part of great Baptist churches growing up and was familiar with how the Annie Armstrong offering was put to such incredible use.
But growing up in Alabama, it's kind of scary to think that we were going to come out here to try something that we had not done before, that we knew the Lord was calling us to, but didn't want to do it alone.
The context here in Las Vegas is much different than the context in Alabama, and one of that is just religious awareness. 60% of our city would identify with no religion at all. And because of that, I think we have a unique opportunity to introduce them to who Jesus is. It really makes me think of Maki's story. I met Maki for the first time. He showed up at one of our events before we launched called an invite night.
My name is Maki Pizzolo. I'm a professional MMA fighter, which is a professional mixed martial arts fighter. I never thought that God would love a person that fights and looks towards violence for a living. But before Favorite City Church started, Joseph led me to Christ. And I would say that today, my life is blessed. I couldn't even put it into words. My guy is blessing me left and right, bro. Yeah, that's legit. I didn't even know church planting was a thing until I met them, but and I'm looking forward to be able to go out and help make more disciples and really turning the tides in people's lives.
Yeah, so now we're in a space where we're seeing over 150 people engaging at our church. We've seen over 30 professions of faith. So the freedom that we get from the Annie Armstrong Easter offering is that we get to engage with people like my friend Maki. We get to take our time, and then that's where we're able to see the disciple-making process happen and the church be born.
Are touched by the video we just watched showing the work of Joseph and Christian Gibbons and all the work they're doing in Las Vegas. It's amazing that a ministry started by Annie Armstrong is still reaching others for you. Please bless their ministry and the people around them who need to know you. May our hearts be softened and our wallets be open in order that we may help the Gibbons ministry through Annie Armstrong offerings. I pray the goals this church set for the offering during this Easter season will be reached and even exceeded. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Carolyn. Well, I get the opportunity to be your service host today, and not only to welcome you, but to just share very quickly a couple of things that are going on. So I want to just bring you up to speed. And for those of you who may not know, maybe you're visiting, it's like, well, who is this guy that just baptized these people? I have the privilege to be the senior pastor here at Trading Ford Baptist Church. And my name is Mike Motley, and I'm so glad to be able to share this Easter Sunday with you. Couple of quick announcements. Next Sunday after church, we'll have a short meeting with all ministry leaders. If you're a ministry leader, a small group leader, or on a serve team, please make every effort to attend that next Sunday. Also, there will be a kids ministry Pinewood Derby car race next Sunday, April the 7th at 12 noon. That's at First Baptist Salisbury, and you're invited to come out and support our kids as they race. Used to be just the RA guys, but now we have the girls that participate too, so we're looking forward to that. Also, the registration is still open for concealed carry class that's going to be held April the 20th. And the sign-up sheet can be found in the foyer. And if you're interested, please see Butch Julian for more information or get in touch with the church office. Also, the Joy Club will be meeting Thursday, April the 11th at 11 a.m. Cost is $4 per person. And the entertainment will be Daryl Connor, great local musician. And mark your calendars. We're having a ministry expo Sunday night, April the 28th at 6 p.m. The plan is hopefully to have that in the newly renovated student center in what used to be the old sanctuary. And I'm looking forward to you seeing what they've done with it. It looks great. So that is the things that are listed on the announcements this morning. I would add to that a prayer request. Please pray for the missions team from Trading Ford as we leave out early in the morning. Pray for safety, yeah, but not just for safety. Pray that God will indeed use us for His purposes as we travel to Honduras. I'm excited about it, and I'm looking forward to going to bed really early tonight so I can get up really early in the morning to head out. We will be meeting here at the church at 4 a.m. to be able to head to the airport at Charlotte. So just pray for us as we make that trip, that God would be glorified in it. Now let's glorify God as we sing His praises together. Are you ready to worship this morning? Let's stand up and let's pour out our hearts in worship.
We serve a risen Savior today. We want to sing His praise, His glory. So let's let that glory rise before His throne this morning.
Let's sing it out. Singing, oh. Let the glory,
let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of the King rise among us. Let it rise. And let the songs of the Lord rise among us. Let the songs joy of the King rise among us. Let it rise. Singing, oh, let it rise. Singing, oh, let it rise. Let's sing that one more time.
Excited to be here with you on this Easter morning, and I want to read a quick passage from Psalm 118 that speaks of a great struggle. And after that, it says, "Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone." Speaking of Jesus, this is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. As we think of that this morning, and as we begin to continue in song of singing Cornerstone, let's think of that whole process that was ordained by the Lord, prophesied that Jesus would be that cornerstone that was put in place that we may be saved. Join with me as we sing.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Darkness seems to hide his face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Shall come with trumpet sounds. Oh, may I then in him be found, pressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Christ alone. The cornerstone. He is the one that our lives, our hope, our faith is built on, and he is not dead. He is alive, and because he lives, man, we can face anything because we know that our God is alive. And let's continue to worship him together. I believe in the Son. I believe in the risen One. I believe I overcome by the power of His blood. Amen. Amen. Song join the one that never ends because he lives.
I was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the stone away. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I'm alive. I'm alive because he lives.
Amen.
Amen. Let my song join the never ends because he lives. I can face tomorrow because he lives. Every fear is gone. I know he holds my life, my future in his hands. I'm alive, I'm alive because he lives. Amen, amen. Let my song join the one that never ends. Amen, amen. I'm alive because he
Father God, we come this morning, Lord, we recognize Jesus dying on the cross paid for our sins, but the hope, the joy that we get from knowing that he rose from the grave, Lord, it gives us that assurance that you do exactly as you say you're going to do. And so, Lord, we come this morning to celebrate, to give you joy, to give you glory, to give you praise, to give you worship. Now, our prayer is that as we praise you, that it brings a smile to your face, and that you have the freedom to reign and inhabit the praises of your people this morning. So, Lord, be in this place as you are and move in mighty, mighty ways. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Wow. It's a privilege to stand before you today. For the last few weeks, I've been doing a series leading up to this very day. Leading up to this Resurrection Sunday. And I've tried to dig up passages of Scripture that were not as familiar to look at what I've called Easter through different eyes. Kind of like when Jesus was arrested and Peter swung his sword and cut off Malchus' ear and Jesus healed him. We looked at that whole experience through the eyes of Malchus. And then Jesus' trial through the eyes of someone that's unseen, but they are mentioned in Scripture. Pilate's wife, who sent a note to him to say, don't have anything to do with condemning this innocent man. Different eyes. And then a Roman centurion that had seen lots of people crucified, who on this particular occasion, looking on Jesus, said, there's something different about this man. Surely he was the Son of God. Well, today we're here to celebrate the resurrection. So, what angle do we find that would be a little different to look at the resurrection of Jesus Christ? We're going to be in John chapter 20. We'd invite you to find your place there in your Bibles. But we're going to be reading a portion of the resurrection account from the Gospel of John. And all four Gospels, of course, tell of Jesus rising from the dead. They all agree on the basic facts, but each one gives slightly a little different insight. And in looking at John's account today, we're going to see Easter through different eyes, through the eyes of the disciple Thomas, through Thomas. Just what do we know about Thomas? Well, let's just kind of rattle off some things. First of all, we know that he was one of 12 disciples that Jesus had chosen. And his name happens to, in the New Testament, appear 12 times. 12 times. Now, compare that with someone like Simon Peter. His name appears 156 times. It's like Simon Peter's the star quarterback, and Thomas is the offensive lineman that nobody recognizes unless they don't do their job. He doesn't get a lot of press. 12 mentions in the New Testament. But then again, 12 mentions in the New Testament. That is significant. And what do we know about him through those 12 mentions? Well, honestly, John writes about Thomas more than any of the other gospel writers. It's through John that we learn that Thomas was called Didymus, as we'll see today. And that word Didymus, if you're using the King James Version or some other older version, it just simply means the twin. He was a twin. Just like we had twin sisters that followed the Lord in baptism today. Thomas was a twin. So he had a twin brother or sister. Something else we learn from John about Thomas is, in John chapter 11, Jesus made a statement, come on guys, talking to the disciples, we are going to go to Judea. And if you read the greater context, you realize that Mary, Martha, and Lazarus lived in a little town in Bethany, and Jesus was saying, we got to go there. And Jesus was about to raise Lazarus from the grave, from the dead. But as they were going there, the disciples kind of spoke up. Just, excuse me, Jesus, the last time we were in that area, they wanted to stone you. They wanted to kill you. And you're saying, that's where we're going. Jesus said, yeah, that's where we're going. And it was at that point that, again, Thomas spoke up and made this statement. He said, well, let's all just go and die with you, Jesus. It could be that Thomas was a little bit of a pessimist. He was committed, but he was kind of like a little bit of that doomsday guy. That was just, for him, the glass was always half empty. You follow? That's Thomas. But he was committed. Oh my, he was committed, and for 3 years had followed Jesus. Now, in the 20th chapter, we are told at the beginning of it what happened earlier that morning. Mary Magdalene and some other ladies were first at the tomb. And they had gone there to grieve and to care for his body, not to worship a resurrected Jesus. Because even though Jesus had talked about rising from the dead, they just didn't get it. Those of you who have been involved in education, perhaps in your career, have you ever looked out at your class and just realized sometimes they're just not getting it? The light bulb is not coming on. They didn't understand. That's one of the reasons why I believe that the Bible is ultimately 100% true. Because if it were a book of propaganda and I were one of the disciples, I would want it to make it, you know, have me look good, right? And the Bible's just more honest than that. The ladies went to the tomb to care for Jesus' body. And the reason that they were going on Sunday morning was because that's the day after the Sabbath, and they could not go. And on the Sabbath day, break the Sabbath to care for his corpse, because his corpse had not had a chance to be prepared as was their Jewish custom. Now, Mark's account tells us that as the ladies approached the tomb, they were concerned as to how they were going to move the stone away that sealed the entrance to the tomb, not to mention the fact that the New Testament tells us that it was guarded by soldiers. But when Mary got there, she saw the tomb open. Now let me try to explain. As I've tried to study this and understand it, honestly, my thinking has changed as to what I believe that looked like. There's a picture that I took to try to help us maybe understand. This is a large piece of rock. I stepped it off yesterday. It's almost 6 feet across. Would you believe that, do you recognize it? It's a millstone. This millstone came from the farm that I was raised on. And from the time I was a little kid, my dad showed me where it was at, and only a little part of it was sticking up. And I had dreams of dragging it out. I took a shovel, and I shoveled underneath of it and ran a steel cable up through that middle hole. The tractor that we had at that time, that 8-in Ford would not budge that millstone. It wouldn't budge it. So my dad had the grand idea, you know what? I will donate it to Ellis Park. And that's where it's at right now. Down next to the horse riding rink in part of the Ellis Park complex. That came from our farm. Folks, I'm here to tell you, the stone that sealed the tomb was much larger than that. Much larger than that. And, you know, I thought about while I was there, it's up on some, you know, pedestal rocks, and I thought about trying to grab one corner, and it's, why bother? Why bother? It's over a foot thick, almost 6 feet in diameter. Well, let me tell you something. The stone that sealed Jesus' tomb was much larger than that. But I used to have an idea in my mind, keep the picture up here for a moment, that the stone that sealed Jesus' tomb was something like a big round boulder that you would just kind of roll, you know, kind of end over end. But that's not actually how tombs were sealed. They would have a big round rock, much like this, and in front of the tomb, there would be kind of a groove cut where that door, that stone would roll and seal it. And many times it would be on an incline so that when it sealed the tomb, you would have to roll it uphill. And as the ladies were heading that way, they thought, how in the world are we gonna, how are we gonna get this stone moved? And just like I have to do sometimes, how are we gonna make it happen? I don't know, but something will work out. Something will work out. Now, if you go back and you read the four gospel accounts, It seems to me, by the wording that's chosen, that this stone hadn't just been rolled uphill and a piece of firewood stuck under the edge of it to hold it, to keep it from rolling back, but it was literally blown off of the tracks. It was laying off to the side, and one gospel account says an angel was sitting on top. I'm here to tell you, Jesus blew the doors off of death. He didn't just roll the stone back, but my friend, he destroyed our enemy of death, and we'll talk about that. So when Mary and those other ladies got to the tomb, they found it open, and she looked inside and just was utterly amazed at what she saw. And she went back to tell Jesus' other disciples about what she had seen. And the gospel account tells how Peter and John ran to the tomb. Now, these were fishermen, and they were not wimpy guys. They were strong guys. They were used to the outdoors, and they were still strong and in the prime of their life. And they ran. The gospel record tells us that Peter and John ran, and John, who was writing it, happens to mention that he outran Peter. Again, it just makes me smile. The Bible is a divine book, but it's a human book written by human authors, and that shows through. But John got there first and won the race, but it was Peter that had the boldness to go inside. And when they got there, they found no corpse as they had expected, but rather signs of a miracle. He was gone. But they hadn't seen him yet. Later that same day, the disciples were hidden away behind a locked door in fear, and Jesus appeared to them miraculously, even though all the doors were locked. But Thomas was not there. And it's here in the Resurrection Day story that I'll pick up in John chapter 20 and verse 24. But Thomas, one of the 12, who was called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came, that first time, that is. So the other disciples were saying to him, "We have seen the Lord." Thomas, we saw him ourselves. We witnessed it with our own eyes. We have seen the Lord. But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hand the imprint of the nails, and put my finger into the place of the nails, and put my hand into his side where that spear had gone, I will not believe." It makes me think. Now, we don't know this from the Bible record, but it makes me think that Thomas, while Jesus was being crucified, may have been standing somewhere way back in the crowd, watching what was taking place. Not close enough to be identified or to be arrested, but watching as Jesus hung there on the cross. And he said, "Unless I see in his hands the imprint of the nails, and put my finger in the place of the nails, and put my hand inside of his side, that wound, I will not believe." Thomas is saying, "I need evidence. I want proof." Well, eight days later, verse 26, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was with him. That time, he was there. And Jesus came, and the doors having been shut, and stood in their midst. Now, let me just point something out. This is not the focus of our message today, but I'm here to tell you, Jesus was raised in a physical body. It was a bodily resurrection, not just a spiritual resurrection, as some liberals would have us believe. He was bodily raised from the dead, but Jesus was all of a sudden appearing behind locked doors pretty regularly. That resurrected body had properties that a normal physical body didn't have. just like our resurrected bodies will have some properties that these old bodies don't experience. And we're thankful for that. Yes, amen. Amen. And here's what transpired. Jesus came, and the doors having been shut, he stood in their midst and said, "Peace be to you." Now, if I had been Jesus, and I'm not, and I'm thankful I'm not, I'm just one that tries to follow him, I might have been tempted to say, "You bunch of knuckleheads. You bunch of unbelieving disciples. I've been trying to tell you for months that this was going to happen. Why didn't you get it?" But he, you know what? He just said, "Peace be to you." And then he said to Thomas. Now, if I'd been Thomas, I'd been wanting to get back in the back, you know, kind of get down behind Peter and James and maybe hope that Jesus wouldn't notice me. But Jesus called him out and said, "Thomas, place your finger here and see my hands. And take your hand and put it into my side." It's almost like Jesus knew what he was thinking. Yeah, newsflash, Jesus knows what you're thinking. God knows everything, and he doesn't have to Google it. And he knows our thoughts. "Thomas, place your finger here, see my hands, take your hand, put it in my side. Do not continue in disbelief, but be a believer." Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." What an exclamation! And I love the fact that our English translation puts an exclamation point here. "My Lord and my God." That is, you can't just say that quietly. No, it demands emphasis. And for all those who would say that Jesus was just a good teacher, but he was not God in human flesh, he was not divine, if that were the case, Jesus would have had to have corrected Thomas at this point. "Oh, I'm not God." But Jesus didn't correct him, because Thomas was exactly right. "You're my Lord and my God." Verse 29, "And Jesus said to him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are they who do not see and yet believed." Or believe, present tense. "So then, with many other signs, Jesus also performed in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these have been written so that you may believe that Jesus Christ is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you might have life in His name." The Gospel of John specifically gives the reason it was written. Oh, wow, how powerful this is. As I've read this passage of Scripture to you, these few verses from the Gospel of John, and we saw where Thomas finally sees and believes. Folks, there's two things quickly I want to share with you, and then we're done. Number one, I'm so impressed by what I did not hear. Have you ever had somebody say to you those four weighty words, "I told you so"? Have you ever had anybody say that? I have. Or, and I've talked about this before, I've also been at times that guy that just couldn't resist. "I told you so. I told you so." You know what we do not read in the 20th chapter of John? Jesus saying, "I told you so." There's no condemnation from Jesus. No hard time about, why weren't you there, Thomas? 8 days ago, you would have seen me the very day I rose and you weren't there. You don't get that. Just lots of love and tons of proof. Now, Thomas had honest doubt. Is it a sin to doubt? In some situations, perhaps. But sometimes God knows our heart. We're struggling, maybe with our faith. And instead of Jesus being unkind and cruel, he is loving to Thomas. No, I told you so. No berating, because Jesus knew Thomas's heart. Jesus knew that Thomas had followed him faithfully for 3 years. Don't lose sight of that. But Thomas needed evidence to believe, and Jesus provided it. And we have the record of that. Now, folks, we have the record of what transpired. And you say, yeah, but I wasn't there. Well, were you there in Gettysburg when Lincoln stood and said, 67 years ago? I wasn't there. But I've read, and actually at one time, when we were in junior high, I don't know if you were in that same history class with me, Brent, but I think we had to memorize the Gettysburg Address. I couldn't repeat it now. Don't ask me to. But the point is this, was I there to hear Lincoln say those words? I was not. But eyewitnesses were. And they recorded for history proof that it actually happened and that it took place. We have the proof of eyewitnesses like Thomas. I'm so impressed by what Jesus didn't say. It makes me thankful for the same grace that he shows me when I struggle. But secondly, I am incredibly impressed by what I do hear. A man who was painfully crucified is now standing there speaking to Thomas, saying, you want proof? I'll give you proof. But Jesus, perhaps Thomas did see him on the cross, see him die. I would say chances are good that he did. For almost 25 years, I've had the privilege to be pastor of Trading Ford Baptist Church. And through those years, I've had the... Well, I'll say it's a blessing, although it's a hard one. A blessing to be a part of many Christian funeral services. And many a dear friend that I've had to have part in putting in the ground in our cemetery next door. Folks, would it be a big deal if just waltzing in here today, someone that I helped put in the ground were to come and be with us? Oh, there's so many. I couldn't begin to name them all. But some folks that come to mind, oh my. Jeff Horton, who led in this project when this building was built. Jewel Alley, his sweet wife Ruby. Paul Wilson, gentle giant of a man. Those and so many others, if they were to join me on stage and you went to their funeral and you stood at the cemetery as their dead body was buried. And then there are others. I recall Dan Barber. I stood at his bedside when he took his last breath. I saw him die. If these that I've named were standing with me on the stage today, would you think it would be a big deal? Well, folks, I'm here to tell you, the one who was talking to Thomas had been crucified and his dead body was placed in a tomb. It was a big deal that Jesus was standing there. He who once was dead now lives and lives forevermore. I'm impressed of what I hear. A man who had been dead was now speaking to Thomas. And folks, he's alive still today. And I've got good news in closing. Death has lost its sting. Some of you saw me carry in a prop before the service and maybe made some of you nervous. I don't mean to make you nervous, but you just hang in there with me for a moment. From my gun closet at home, I picked up an oddball this morning. This is actually a Swiss military rifle that I obtained years ago. I like old stuff and I like firearms, but with firearms, firearm safety is of utmost importance. Treat every gun as if it were loaded. And know and be certain of what you're shooting at and past it. Just basic rules of gun safety. You have to treat firearms with respect. But there's a backstory on this. I got it years ago from an old man who repaired watches and clocks. And he had this, and believe it or not, he had turned it into a floor lamp. And I liked it better as just a firearm, and I started doing a little research. This was before the days of the internet. And believe it or not, I was a student at that time in Mitchell Community College, and my history professor, I told him about it, and he said, well, I'll help you look it up. I've got some books. And I said, well, how do I get it? Do I need to take a picture? He said, no, just bring it in. Can you imagine that happening today? Me walking in a community college carrying a rifle. I'd be in big trouble. But this was in the 1980s, and the world was a different place then. And I found out that this particular old rifle, oh, wow, it's heavy. It's 41 caliber, rimfire, tubular magazine, first bolt-action repeating military rifle ever made. Doesn't mean that it's super valuable. It's not. But there's something about this old rifle. I couldn't shoot it if I wanted to. Because when I looked more closely, I found out that the firing pin that strikes the cartridge is gone. It's been taken away. And I've got some good news for you. In the same way that this, the only way it could be harmful is if you picked it up and used it like a club. It hurt somebody then. But folks, that old rifle can't shoot anybody anymore. Because the firing pin, the thing that makes it lethal, has been removed. And in the same way, the Bible tells us that Jesus took away the sting of death. And Jesus has pulled the firing pin, y'all. We don't have to fear death. Jesus has pulled the firing pin. Jesus has removed the sting of death. Because of that, our loved ones who have died in the Lord, we know we're going to see them again. Oh my, this past week, I prayed for folks that have lost loved ones. A brave firefighter in Davidson County, just right across the river. pray for his family. He passed away. He knew the Lord. Pray for the Metcalf family. And pray for the family of a young man named Noah, 17 years old, who lost his life in an automobile accident just this past week. Death has brought great pain, but because Jesus rose again, it changes everything. He pulled the pin on death. He took away the sting. If you know him as Savior, if you do what Jesus told Thomas that people need to do, Jesus said, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are they who have not seen, but yet believe. If you've never placed your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior, I would encourage you, take that step of faith this morning. I talked about Thomas having honest doubts, and I believe he did. But I heard a great quote from Erwin Lutzer this past week, and he said, the opposite of honest doubt is dishonest doubt. Where God provides you plenty of evidence to believe, and you just choose not to. The choice is yours. I can't make you believe, and God won't make you believe, but the evidence is here. And I'm so thankful for a man named Thomas who struggled, but Jesus didn't give up on him. You may struggle, but Jesus has not given up on you. We're going to have a time of invitation. If you've never trusted Christ, it's as simple as ABC. Admit that you're a sinner and that you need God's forgiveness. B, believe that Jesus is God's Son and that He died on a cross in your place, taking your place, dying for your sin. And then C, just confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. Publicly be willing to say, yes, Jesus, I believe in you. I trust you. I want to accept that gift of eternal life that you offer. Father, as we head into this time of invitation, I pray that you'll touch every heart. I pray that you will, Lord, draw those that have perhaps believed but struggled and strayed. Draw also those who have never yet put their faith in Jesus as their Savior. Draw them to the point of salvation this morning, and we'll praise you for how you work, for what you do. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together as we have this hymn of invitation. We invite you to come.
He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall
going to dismiss in prayer, and I ask Dave Brewer if he would come and lead us in our closing prayer. But for those who were baptized this morning, we have your baptism certificates. We'd invite you to come, and we'd like to present those to you today. If you would please make your way forward, we've got your baptism certificates. Amen. Amen. And Jenna? Scott? Belinda? And Karen? And Sharon? And one more sign of affirmation that we love them and are praying for them. Amen. God bless you. Going to have a closing prayer. Brother Dave, you come and lead us in that. What a wonderful time just celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ with you all today. Amen.
Let us bow. Father, again, we come before you and we realize you are truly our Lord and our God. And we thank you, Lord, for what you've done for us. And we know that that's all we can do is thank you, Lord. You died for us. You made that payment for our sin. And the greatest of all, you come back to prove that you were God in the flesh and made that payment for us. And we have great hope in the future because of what you've done. And we thank you for that. We want to pray for the Honduras mission trip, Father, as they go tomorrow. Give them safety and protection as you promise you will. And we pray that for all the believers here, Lord, as we go in a messed up, mixed up world. We pray that you'll give us wisdom that you promise, give us guidance that you promise, and just have your hand in each believer here as we go. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Of sin and darkness, whose love is mine? same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. God that never fails will not fail.